The importance of love has been proclaimed throughout the history of the Christian Church. We are told of God's love and His great mercy, but it is not often that we hear of the firmness of that love. Dr. Percy Collett has traveled all the way to the planet of heaven and returned with God's message for us today. As Dr. Collett shares with us now, listen and learn what Jesus is saying to the church.
Yes, friends, this is Dr. Percy Collett, and I did travel all the way to the planet of heaven. The planet heaven is 2 million miles around it, a great planet. Inside of this planet is where God is, and God is love. And I was instructed by Jesus what love is, and to bring love back to this earth, the pure love of heaven. Heaven is a place of order, as we've said, a place of music, a place of administration, but it is also a place of love. The love of God, our rich, is the love of God. So my Bible teaches that God is love. God being love instructed me through Jesus Christ to operate back on this earth when I came back here, to operate under the power of love. As I told you, I sat on the love seat with Jesus, and the feathers of God, God's great hand, His left hand, holding that tremendous, beautiful feathers in His hand, greater than the wings of a hen, as Jesus looked on Jerusalem, and He said, O Jerusalem, Jerusalem that killest the prophets, how long would I have gathered thee as a hen does her brood, and you would not? You see, a hen is a illustration of the love for little chicks. And so how much greater is God, His love for His whole earthly beings. And God loved us, and for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish. Now, believing in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. So there's a procedure and a process to go through to go to heaven, to be saturated and glorified with God in love. So we believe they're prayer intercessors, and they're holy people of God. And it is the holy people of God that will be able to bring forth this love upon the earth, the love. And the love operates through His children here upon the earth. If you read in Thessalonians, in the 5th chapter, the last chapter, and you start at the 23rd verse, and the very God of peace sanctify you wholly, and I pray God, your whole spirit and soul and body, prepared blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Notice, it says body right here, it says spirit and body. There's three right there, spirit, soul, and body. This is exactly what the human body is made of. Be preserved, and that uses the word blameless, blameless, unto the coming. Faithful is He that is has called you, who also will do it. Brethren, pray for us. Now, this was a selected few there in the Bible days, a selected few. And He says, greet the brethren, which also includes the women. Greet them, because there's neither male nor female in the body of Christ, that is, in the bodies of the intercessors and the holy men of God. In the Bible, the Apostle Paul and all of the apostles of that day, and also the great men of God of that day, they walked all through Greece and all these places, and they were so full of love for one another. And it says, greet all the brethren with the holy gifts. I charge you by the Lord that this epistle be read unto all the holy brethren. Where you know there's holy men of God in this world today. And I'm giving this message directly to the holy men of God, to the intercessors, and to those that are called to separate their lives away from the world and give up all the world and be the intercessors and the brethren to carry this message of love to the earth. And then He goes on to say, I charge you by the Lord, this epistle be read unto all the holy brethren. And then He goes on, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Amen. And I say this to you, the holy brethren of God, the grace of Jesus Christ, the grace of God, that grace. And Paul said, thy grace is sufficient. Now, in this message that Jesus told me to bring back to the earth, this special message, was to have a great saturation of love. When this great saturation of love, as these feathers come down from God, from His throne, feathers are going to begin to fall upon God's people, especially among the intercessors. You will see them, they'll fall, you'll be able to put them in the pocket, and they'll be able to walk with them. This is a message that God is going to let His feathers come right down from heaven, come right down to this earth and start falling upon the brethren. Oh, if this isn't going to be a sign of God's heaven, I don't know what is. If you can't, this will be only to the believer. It will not, those feathers will not fall on the worldly people, only on God's people. Therefore, it's God's reality. This is the reality of God coming in person to this earth. Then in this message that Jesus gave me, said to walk in love. Now, what is love? Love, is in the earthly, love is just next to hate. A person can hate in the earthly and be hate somebody 1 minute and kill them the next minute. That's not God's love. That's earthly love. That's passion. That's what happens when they fall in love upon this earth. When the boy and the girl falls in love, they fall in love through passion. The passion of the body. The passion of the body to reproduce and to make children. That's the passion love of this world. But the love of God is altogether different. The love of God comes in spiritual. And therefore, the body becomes full of the love of God. To get saturated with the love of God is one of those, the greatest reality there is in this earth. 40 years ago, I was in about, I never want, and God do not want, God does not want me to remember dates, times, or seasons, or new moons, because time is gone away in my life. So therefore, in the state of Maryland years ago, 40 years ago, it was on a Sunday morning, and we were having church, as we thought, and then the power of the Lord came in, and then there was such a love came over that Sunday morning service, and this was the first time that I participated in the Holy Kiss. Now, the Holy Kiss is not a slobber kiss. You don't slobber over anybody. You don't come and start slobbering, but you do it in a godly way. And it's a beautiful kiss. It's a kiss from the brethren and the sisters. They greet one another, and with a holy kiss, that it's the kiss of love from heaven. Now, I was taught this in heaven. I kissed, my soul kissed my mother, my soul kissed the mother of Jesus, my soul kissed the Apostle Paul, my soul kissed Elijah and Elisha, my soul kissed the prophets. And in this most beautiful reality, and there was no virtue went out of my soul, because if virtue comes into the body of those people who are intercessing, and there were intercessors who pray, holy brethren, I'm talking about holy people, not everybody's holy, but to be a real intercessor, they become and they are holy men of God and holy women of God, because there's neither male or female in the holy kiss. There's neither that. There's no passionate call. But it's a sensation of heavenly love, a sensation of God's love. So then when I sat under the feathers in heaven, I was taught how to greet the brethren and how to greet one another. And you greet one another in the spirit, not in the flesh. You don't just rush up to somebody, put your arms around one another, and just hug one another. It's not done on that fashion. It's done by a connection of the spirit. You look one another in the eyes, in the spirit, right directly in the eyes. And when you look one another in the eyes, in the Holy Spirit, not just grab and hold one another and squeeze them to you, that's not the way it's done. It's done through a connection of the spirit. And when the spirit bears witness, and the spirit bears witness to the other one, then in a lovable way, you greet one another with a holy kiss in the name of the Lord. And greeting one another with a holy kiss is God's Bible way, because in the Thessalonians, it tells us to do it. And so we obey the scriptures, don't we? Do not we obey the word of the Lord and obey the Bible? Don't we obey? Don't you believe the Apostle Paul knew what he was talking about? Because the Apostle Paul, oh, it was wonderful. It was wonderful in heaven. As I walked up to the Apostle Paul, this man of God that had walked all through Greece, that he'd carried the message, that had stood on Mars Hill and declared the unknown God, There it was just like we'd known one another for a million years, or a thousand years, or even a day. And I looked Paul with my soul, right into Paul's soul eyes, and I looked in his soul eyes, and it was not saying, kiss me. I didn't say, kiss me. But we came to one another, and as our eyes came in contact, oh, you could just see in Paul's eyes the power of the living God. His eyes were like, just like the flaming fire of God himself. And then he said, oh, I know you have it. Look, your eyes are full of the flame of the power of God. And then he didn't say, greet me with a holy kiss. I didn't say, greet you, Paul, with a holy kiss. But automatically, with automation, automatically, our heads begin to come closer and closer. And I kiss Paul. Hallelujah! And Paul kissed me in heaven. And I was told that that was the very thing to do, to kiss, the holy kiss. Yes, friends, to kiss with a holy kiss. As I said, I kissed Jesus. I kissed the archangel. I kissed the prophets. I kissed Wigglesworth. I kissed Gypsy Smith. And we all greeted one another in heaven with a holy kiss. And he told me, go down on the earth and tell the holy men of God not to destroy this wonderful, 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 wonderful part of the Scripture, but to greet one another with a holy kiss. But then I was taken over to God, and I didn't kiss God on the lips. But you know what I did? I kissed God's feet, both of God's feet. And kissing God's feet in heaven was the most wonderful. God put both of his feet out, and Jesus walked over and kissed the feet of God the Father. And Jesus did the same thing, kissed his Father's feet. And then they walked up, many of them walked up the prophets and did the same thing, and kissed the feet of God. And it was the most wonderful reality to do this great reality of the great power of God, to kiss God's feet. A privilege just to kiss the feet of God. No wonder I'm not the same. No wonder I've changed. No wonder I don't want that old tennis racket anymore. No wonder I don't want those guns anymore. No wonder I don't want them things anymore, because the simple reason is, God, at 81 years old, I'm telling you the message from heaven, what to do upon this earth. So then, it brings back into the church, and after the church becomes holy, not unholy, people should never kiss one another, because it could turn into something very distasteful. Not people that are not holy should never kiss one another, because this would rise up on them. A bodily feeling. But the kiss of heaven is a kiss in the Spirit. And you must be fully in the Spirit before you kiss one another, fully in the Spirit of God, surrendered and really and truly surrendered to the living God. So then in heaven, when I kissed my mother, and I kissed the mother of Jesus, and then I was around there, but kissing Jesus himself. Can you imagine Jesus be kissing me, and me, and I'm kissing Jesus? What a lovable Savior is Jesus. What a wonderful God the Son he is. Now, friends, bringing this message back to the earth, bringing this love, the love of reality and the love of truth, God's love in heaven is brought by the operation of the love of God to the love of on this earth, God's way of love upon this earth. The love of God is going to become more powerful upon this earth. God the Father has directed me through Jesus Christ to bring this message to the earth, to have a holy people, a people that are holy, a people that are holy, men that are holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. And you know what they were singing in heaven in the heavenly language? Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty in the heavenly language. Holy. He is a holy God and a God of power. So then with this message of love in heaven, then the heavenly love song sang, the song of love. And it went something like this in the heavenly song. Love of God, love of God. Interpreted it into English. Ikaravashanda, Iravavala. Irawala, Irawala, Awa, the love of God in heaven. How beautiful it is when brethren dwell together in unity and in love. So therefore, with a great, holy, powerful God, I have been invited to go to a band of 100 love brothers, 100 love sisters together in a body of intercession. You know what? This intercession power upon this earth is going to get so powerful to take the land for the love of God and for Jesus. Going to go into the bodies, bring in the love, and this is going to happen before the great explosion takes place. So I was instructed by Jesus to organize a love band of intercessors upon this earth, all around the world. And love will really work when nothing else will work. I remember one time this man started really what I'd call in old-fashioned language, vilifying me. He started calling me names, all kinds of names. I heard a judge says one time there in the court of law saying, somebody can call you all the names you want, but it doesn't give you a license to beat that man up. It doesn't do that. So then this man called me all kinds of names. You know, I'd answer, I love you, friend. I said, and he'd slap at me, and I'd stand back a little bit and say, I love you, friend. And then he called me a bad name, and he says, I love you, friend. And I said that 12 times. And you know what he did? He started crying, tears coming down. He said, you mean to say that I can't make you mad? I said, no. Now, the intercessors do not get mad. There'll be no madness in the true intercessors. There'll be no harsh words. There'll be no words of misunderstanding. It'll be a perfect love band together. And can you imagine? Can you imagine thousands upon thousands upon thousands of these love brothers and love sisters out in the world with the power of God and the message of the intercession and prayer going forth in the land to bring the power of God upon this earth in a great, great love message? Now here's the love message from God. Love thy enemies. Jesus said to love your enemies. My, would that be hard to do? Not if you got Jesus in your heart, to love your enemies. You mean to say you got an enemy? And so therefore, what does it mean, love your enemy? It doesn't mean this earthly walk where they take atomic bombs, machine guns, and great big battleships, shooting these shells upon the enemy. But you know what? It's Jesus said, go back to the earth and love your enemies. I said, how about the soldiers, Jesus? Said, love them. I said, how about the Jews? Jesus said, love them. How about the communists? Jesus, he said, love them. About the Russians? Jesus said, he'd love them. About the Chinese? Love them. How about the communists? Jesus said, love them. Love them. Love them. And I tell you, if you can show the Russian communists or the Chinese communists love, if we can just get to that very power where we show the Russian government love, it's no use opposing them. Because what they'll do, they'll just build more military. So in confrontation of military between two opposing powers, they build up more guns, more swords, more atomic bombs, and the confrontation is going to get bigger and bigger and bigger. But the love of God. Now here's the way Jesus told me that will happen. When the message I'm bringing back to the earth, these brethren and these sisters will have the power over the devil in the bodies of these people. I have tried it. And here's what the power will do. They will absolutely not have to use a word. They'll be so full of the love of God and so full of the power of God, they'll just put their hands up very quietly and touch that opposing power real quietly upon them, and they'll go down with a flop. They'll go down under the power of God and wonder what's happened to them. Because it was Ananias and Sapphira that came before Paul. When they came before Paul and they lied how much they'd given. They said they give all we got, but they was holding something back. You see, they lied to the Holy Ghost. And what happened? You know what? Paul had that power and they both fell dead. And you know what? I saw that happen in down in South America. This powerful man. What he wasn't going to do to me. I was there in St. Laurent having that revival there at that time in that prison. Oh, he come up with great power. And he called his army together like a bunch of guards to get me out of there. And I walked up to him, and he thought I was going to shake hands with him and say yes. I put my hand and fingers quietly up to his head, and you know what happened to him? He fell down dead. 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 He fell down dead. It's a dangerous thing to put your hand upon the child of God, for the Bible says, touch not my prophets and do them no harm. Do my people no harm, Jesus said. This is the word. He said it differently. Touch not the prophets of mine. Touch not my prophets, said Jesus in the earth. Do them no harm. If you do, you yourself are very sure to fall dead in this great operation that's taking place. So do not defile your heart against the people of God. It's dangerous. So then in this great power of love come upon this earth, you mean to say that the love of God would cause anybody? No, not that. It's the power of God to destroy. What happens to that person many times? Well, if they were a believer, they'd go into the outer perimeter of heaven. That's where they'd go. And they'd be saved as by fire, because it's the fire and the power of God. God is a consuming fire. And in this love, in this power, in this great reality, these precious, lovable people will have the fire of God upon their lives in order to have power. And this will come there in the great power of command. There's coming a time of command through the love of God. And the power of command is this, is where these earthly banks and these earthly organization operations, these earthly businesses, with the power of command, these lovable brothers are going to be able to go into their offices. And they're going to say, we have need of your business. You are not making any money now of need of your business. And you know what? The Lord told me that God's people are going to start a bank. And they were going to have an international bank. And the bank is going to be plenty of money for operation of this great move of God of the last days. And you know what's going to happen? Worldly businesses are going to get converted. Going to get converted, and they're going to say, what can I do? I'm not making any money. And they'll say, well, we'll put it over into the great power of God, God's great bank. We'll turn our business, and then they'll start making money to use for God. And this is the power of command. And the power of command is coming upon this earth, Jesus said, through the love and the power of God. Now, back in heaven with this great love feast we had several earth hours in heaven demonstrating love among the angels. And it was a love feast. God the Father, God is love, was in charge of the whole thing. And it was just such a wonderful time to see all the angels in a real, real powerful body of love. There was all, it was the love time in heaven. It was the love feast going on. It was the love feast. And this great love feast of heaven was so wonderful. And I participated in it. And I'm telling you, talk about putting our arms around one another, our heavenly arms, soul arms around one another. And I was going over there all mixing. You talk about a party. That was a heavenly party. And we were there drinking in the Spirit of God. And oh, what a time it was as we were there enjoying a love feast in heaven. And you know then what we did? Oh, I've got something to tell you now. We sat down to a heavenly table. Maybe 10 million of them, who knows, because you don't count. And here appeared rows and rows and rows of tables. Oh, rows of tables. And from one end of heaven you could see to the other end. Jesus sat at the end of the tables, and this wonderful table. And the tablecloths, oh, they were just like beautiful silk. And upon that table appeared bowls and more bowls and more bowls of heavenly fruit. We sat at that table, and this was the love feast, partaking and eating from the fruit of heaven, from the tree of life. And we just ate this wonderful, wonderful fruit from heaven, and there was many of it, and those bowls kept staying full. As you would take a piece of that fruit and eat it, this wonderful love fruit, we would eat it. And you talk about pears, it was every kind of a heavenly fruit you could imagine. And I do love fruit. Out in California, they brought to me when I went out to Brother C.D. Sewell out there, and we went in that hotel in the Marriott out there in close to Anaheim there to stay that night. I got there. I was going to appear on that show. Brother and Sister Krause out there, Paul and Jan Krause, prayed for them. But they brought up on that table the biggest bowl of fruit, California fruit, that I ever saw. It was stacked high, and they said, we all sat around that table and eat the California fruit. There was everything on there. There was all kinds of fruit. There was all kinds of different pears. There was on there all kinds of different, all cut up so nice. And we eat of that fruit together. And so then, but it reminded me somewhat of heaven. But it didn't even begin to touch the great fruit feast we had in heaven. Can you imagine just miles and miles of tables loaded with fruit, and then upon that table, written in God's language, all over the whole tablecloth, God is love. And I participated in that heavenly feast, participated in that feast of heaven. And Jesus said, once every time that God gives the orders, all the saints of God, the church, all the angels, all the prophets, all the major and minor prophets, all the soul winners, and all of the redeemed will gather around that tables in heaven and eat the fruit of heaven. And you know what this fruit does? It gives you knowledge, gives you wisdom, gives you joy, and gives you peace. Can you imagine eating all the fruit you want and no plumbing in heaven? Not one bit of plumbing in heaven, not one bit. Don't need it, not one bit. Partake in there. And you know what I sat? I was privileged to sit right next to Jesus. Oh, my, my, my. Jesus was talking to me, and Jesus would pass every right ate a piece. Jesus put the bowl in front of me. And every time I eat a piece of fruit, another fruit would appear in its place. Right now, and that bowl kept fruit. You didn't have to worry about running out of fruit. You didn't have to worry about it. You didn't have to have a knife to peel it. There was no cores in it. There was no seeds, nothing. And we just ate there for 4 hours, all the fruit we could eat. 4 earthly hours, we sat there just eating, eating, eating the fruit of heaven. This is heaven I'm talking about, my friends. An unlimited supply of everything in heaven. An unlimited supply of the Lord God Almighty's power. Sitting at the table with Jesus. Oh, that song, Jesus has a table spread where the saints of God are fed. We can feast at Jesus' table all the time, come and dine. And Jesus said, this is our heavenly banquet, eating the fruit. You don't need, and then there was the heavenly wine. Oh, I want to tell you, would you believe it? There was wine in heaven, but it was the fruit, the juice of the fruit. There was the juice, great big glasses of the juice in heaven. And this was there in heaven still, the supper of the Jesus. There we drank to Jesus. Hold the glasses up full of the heavenly juice, heavenly fruit, heavenly juice. And that was the greatest banquet that I ever attended in heaven. I went to a heavenly banquet with Jesus. Don't miss heaven, friends. If you miss heaven, you'll miss it all, because heaven's waiting for you. You know, upon this earth, 70 years and 10 few days, may God bless you. And heaven is a real place, a place of banquets, a place of love, a place of wisdom, a place of knowledge, a place of understanding. So you'll sit down and abide with God forever and ever. May God bless you. I'll see you next tape.